Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to introduce our very exciting speaker, Mr. Peter Schweizer. Peter Schweizer is a New York Times bestselling author with his books beating out leftist propaganda 7 times. Some past books that take the number one spot include Secret Empires, Profiles in Corruption, and Clinton Clash. Most recently, Schweizer released his book, Red Handed, exposing the gluttonous American elites' bondage to the Chinese Communist government. In addition to his comprehensive list of forthright literature, Schweizer regularly appears in various media outlets and has been published in the Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, LA Times, and others. He is the president of the Government Accountability Institute and host of the weekly podcast, The Drill Down. In the past, Schweizer worked as a presidential speechwriter for George W. Bush, a Hoover Fellow at Stanford University, and a senior contributor to Breitbart News. Like me, Peter attended his first YAF conference when he was in high school. He later served as a staff member and now sits on the board of Young America's Foundation. This past weekend, I, along with other college students, had the privilege of hearing Schweizer's wisdom as he spoke on the woke movement and how to fight it at YAF's seminar at the Reagan Boyhood Home in Dixon, Illinois. Peter is a champion for the value and inherent dignity of the individual as the very instrument to fight the dehumanization we face as Americans as a result of the ancient tactics of the woke mob. His words provided honest insight, but hope for the power we have to take back the exceptional American idea we know and love. Without further ado, let's all give a warm welcome to Peter Schweizer.
Thank you. Everybody having fun? No, come on, ask. Is everybody having fun? All right, that's what I wanted to hear. Thank you. It's great to be here. I want to talk about a very serious subject, and that is the heart and soul of the battle that's taking place around the globe and in the United States today for the battle of freedom. I want to talk particularly about some of the wealthiest and most well-known and powerful figures in America today and the role that they are playing in aiding and abetting the enemies of freedom. Now, Vladimir Lenin, the Russian revolutionary leader, once said that the capitalists would sell us the rope by which we will hang them. Well, no, actually, he didn't actually say those precise words. What he did say, however, is that the capitalists would provide the Bolsheviks with the means for the destruction of the capitalists. He also went on to describe how the seeking of commerce with the Soviet Union would lead capitalists to be deaf, dumb, and blind to what the Bolsheviks were actually up against. Now, we know that Lenin, of course, did not succeed. The Soviet Union ended up on the ash heap of history, as Ronald Reagan predicted it would. But today we have, I would argue, a more serious threat that we face, and that is from Communist China. And Communist China has ingeniously adopted a strategy that they call elite capture. Elite capture. And what they essentially mean is we are going to buy off key elements of the leadership class in the United States and in other countries. And by doing so, we are going to effectively lobotomize them. We're going to lead America to not have the sort of vigorous leadership that it needs to counter the threat that we propose. Now, what they're looking for, these elites that they're going to capture, is not blind allegiance. They know that these leaders need to maintain commercial and political viability. And if they're true too pro-Chinese in their pronunciations, if they walk in lockstep with everything that Beijing says, that they're going to have no credibility and they're going to be ineffective. So what the Chinese government is looking for, translated from the Chinese, is big help with a little bad mouth. Big help with a little bad mouth. And what that basically means is they are looking for help on the big things that matter most to them. That is access to our technology, access to our capital markets, and the ability to sell their goods in the United States, subsidized by the government, without interference. In other words, no trade barriers. If they get those things from our leaders, they will tolerate criticism about their treatment of the Uyghurs or criticism of human rights. In other words, they're getting the big help. They don't mind the little bad mouth. What I want to do to you today with you is briefly give you a tour around the country and visit three areas and name names, the specific elites that I would argue have been captured by the Chinese Communist Party, and talk about the implications of what that actually means. We're going to visit Washington, D.C. We're going to go to Silicon Valley. We're going to end up at Wall Street, and we are going to discuss some of the biggest names in America and the sweetheart deals that they have secured courtesy of the Chinese dictatorial regime. And what they are getting in return, I would argue, is highly effective service that allows Beijing to advance its agenda deep into the heart of the United States. So let's begin with Washington, D.C., and the most powerful man in the world. Or I guess I would say the most powerful man in the world would be the one that gives Joe Biden his cue cards. But let's just say it's Joe Biden for the sake of argument, and the first family. The Bidens are a classic example of elite capture by the Chinese Communist Party. Now, that's a bold statement to say, but I think the facts and the evidence are overwhelming. Consider this fact. When Joe Biden became the Vice President of the United States, his family had no overseas foreign dealings. They had no dealings in China. They had no background in doing foreign deals in China or anywhere else. But after Joe Biden became Vice President of the United States, President Barack Obama appointed him the point person on U.S. foreign policy towards China. That's a pretty important role, right? Well, imagine what happened after that. Suddenly, the family started to secure very lucrative deals from Chinese governments and the corporations that are controlled by the Chinese government. And the conduit for this was a guy you've probably heard of named Hunter Biden. Now, Hunter Biden has no background in international business, no background in China, no background in private equity, no background. The list could go on and on. But that didn't matter, because what Beijing was interested in doing and has succeeded in doing is securing a financial relationship with the Biden family that makes the Biden family beholden to staying in the good graces of the Chinese government. So what are we talking about here? Well, if you go through the Hunter Biden laptop, as I've done, and you go through the email collections of some of his business partners, who we have been granted access to, you come to the stunning reality that beginning when Joe Biden was Vice President of the United States and extending up until he became President of the United States, the Biden family received some $31 million from Chinese businesses that went directly into their pockets. $31 million. Now, who made those deals happen? Or as my kids would say, or as a lot of kids in this room would say, who made it rain for the Bidens in China? How did that money come about? And what you discover when you reverse engineer it is a stunning fact. And that is that $31 million came from four individuals, all with links to the highest levels of Chinese intelligence. And I'll give you just one example, a guy named Che Feng. Che Feng was involved in a deal that led to a $20 million payout to the Biden family, a $20 million payout. His name was Che Feng. At the same time that he was granting this deal to the Biden family, he was business partners with the Vice Minister of State Security in China. For those of you who are not familiar, the Vice Minister of the State of China is the spy agency that is their FBI, CIA, National Security Agency, Defense Intelligence Agency, all rolled up into one. So in other words, all four of the businessmen that transferred this money to the Biden family had links to the senior levels of Chinese intelligence. And of course, as I said earlier, the Biden family had no background and provided no discernible business service for any of this money. But the problem gets even worse, because what you realize is that not only did the Bidens receive this money, they became involved in commercial deals that directly benefited China in their competition with the United States. So Hunter Biden joins this private equity firm, this investment firm. This is tied up with the $20 million deal. He joins the board of directors. One of the first deals they secure when he joins the board of directors, now remember, he's the vice president of the United States' son. One of the first deals that they do is with a Chinese atomic power company called CGN, China General Nuclear. About a year after they invest in that company, they become an anchor investor, Hunter Biden's firm. CGN is charged by our FBI for stealing nuclear secrets in the United States. They're stealing secrets to small nuclear reactors that they want to use in terms of military technology. They want to put them on submarines. They want to put them on aircraft carriers. There are numerous other deals. The bottom line is this isn't just about the transfer of money to the Biden family. This is about the advancing of the interests of the Chinese state. And America's first family is intimately and directly involved in it because they're getting paid. Now, this is not just a problem of the Bidens, and it's not just a problem of one political party. If you look across the aisle, you could look at the Republican leader in the Senate, Mitch McConnell, and you can see the same kind of bad relationships that exist, and the same concerns about elite capture. In the case of Mitch McConnell, he's married to Elaine Chao, who was a cabinet officer in the Trump administration. She was also a cabinet officer in the George W. Bush administration. They got married back in 1993, but rather than going on a honeymoon per se, they took a trip to Beijing, China, to meet with the leadership of the Chinese State Shipbuilding Corporation, or CSSC. Now, as the name implies, this is a government entity that controls the shipbuilding. It's the largest military contractor in China. And the McConnell-Chao family basically makes a deal with China. They say, we want to go into business with you. And what the Chinese government says to the McConnell-Chao family is, I tell you what, you've got this small shipping company that the Chao family owns. We will build all the large ships for you. We will finance the construction of all those ships. We will find you crews to man those ships. And we'll give you contracts to ship goods around the Asia Pacific region. In other words, we are happy to make you very, very rich. And they got a unique deal that no other shipbuilder in the world had. And guess what happened? The McConnell-Chao family became very rich. And Mitch McConnell today, as a leader of the Republicans in the Senate, has been incredibly soft on China. He will criticize them, but remember, it's always about big help with a little bad mouth. Now, I could go on and on. I could talk about Nancy Pelosi. I could talk about Dianne Feinstein. I could talk about the 23 former US senators and members of Congress who right now at this moment, having left government service, are now lobbying on behalf of Chinese companies. But not just any Chinese companies. 23 former senators and congressmen in the United States from both political parties are lobbying in Washington, D.C. on behalf of Chinese military or intelligence-linked companies. And some of them are making more than $1 million a year doing so. Now, I believe that everybody in the United States has a right to petition their government. I don't believe that that right should extend to the military contractors of our largest military rivals. So we have a major problem in Washington, D.C., but it doesn't end there. Let's go across the country to Silicon Valley and look at what they're up to and the deals that they've secured with Beijing and what it actually means. Now, back in 2016, two of America's most successful and largest technology companies, Google and Facebook, decided that they were going to create a cable linking Hong Kong with San Francisco. And the idea was to connect direct internet service between these two major cities. They hired a Chinese company to develop and lay out the cable. That contractor, of course, was a military contractor, but they didn't let that get into the way. A lot of people raised alarm bells immediately saying, wait, this is not a good idea, because if you lay down this cable, it's going to create very serious national security problems for the United States. Did Google or Facebook care? Of course not. It was only in 2018 when the FBI said, if you complete this cable, you will create a quote unquote unprecedented opportunity for the Chinese government to spy on American citizens. that the Department of Justice shut down the deal. In other words, Mark Zuckerberg, the leadership of Google, didn't care. They knew the technological implications of what they were doing. They didn't care because commerce and deals with China were more important to them. Or we could talk about Bill Gates. Bill Gates, the founder of Microsoft, who, in addition to some of his investments, directly invests in Chinese companies that are enhancing Chinese military capabilities. He's a major shareholder in a company called BYD. What does BYD do? They actually develop missile guidance systems for the Chinese military. Bill Gates is one of their largest investors. Or you could look at the work that he's done with Terra Power, his power company that's trying to build small nuclear reactors. He actually signed a partnership in 2017 with a Chinese nuclear power company that everybody knows. The Obama administration said the same thing, that this is a company that is directly involved in the proliferation of nuclear arms around the world. Do Bill Gates care? No. His plan was to share the technology and build small reactors in mainland China. That only was halted again because the Department of Justice said, no, you can't do that. You're aiding the military capabilities of our chief rival on the global stage. Think about that. Mark Zuckerberg, Bill Gates, the leadership of Google. I would hasten to add to that list, unfortunately, Elon Musk. Elon Musk, a man that I've admired in a lot of respects, founder of Tesla and SpaceX. What did he do? He struck a deal with Beijing in 2017, where Beijing said, we will build you your massive Tesla factory. We will provide all of these benefits to you if you are prepared to do certain things for us. So he struck a deal. And Elon Musk, who in the past had actually been critical of China in terms of human rights, has completely changed his tune. Today, and I quote him extensively in the book, today Elon Musk will say on podcasts and in the media that the Chinese government, the dictatorial regime in Beijing, is far more responsive to the needs of its population than the American government is to its own. Imagine that statement. Does Elon Musk actually believe that? I doubt it, but this is sort of the corrosive effect that these kinds of deals have in the relationships that exist. Finally, as it relates to Silicon Valley, let me just talk about Microsoft and Google and the work that they're doing in artificial intelligence. Anybody here looked at or understand or study artificial intelligence? What you need to know is it is the most important technological advancement in the world right now. President Xi of China, our leadership in Washington, D.C., both have said whoever wins the artificial intelligence race is going to win the technological race. And President Xi of China says, if we win the artificial intelligence race, we will seize the commanding heights in our competition with the United States. So where are Google and Microsoft? Well, Google and Microsoft are both sponsoring artificial intelligence research laboratories in China. And they're sponsoring artificial intelligence laboratories in China that are known to be directly linked to the Chinese military. Microsoft actually takes interns from the People's Liberation Army of China. I don't think we can expect that from Governor Walker in Yaf anytime soon, and thank goodness. But that's the sort of situation we are dealing with when it comes to the titans of American technology. Now, people ask me all the time, they'll say, well, I can understand why Joe Biden or the Biden family might take $31 million from China, but why would Bill Gates? He's worth $100 billion. Why would Elon Musk? He's worth $200 billion. They don't need the money. Why do they do this? It's a good question, and I don't know the answer. You can't really look inside of somebody's heart and know why they're doing it. But if you look at the statements that these individuals have made, they have a deep admiration for the Chinese regime. Now, they don't come out and say that. They use code words. What they will tell you, Elon Musk has said this repeatedly, things are just so efficient in China. If I want to build a factory in China, they just get it done in 9 months, whereas in the United States or in Europe, it can take 2 years. If we have a labor issue or a labor problem, it just gets taken care of so efficiently in China. Well, of course it does. They don't have an independent judiciary. They don't believe in individual rights. They don't believe in property rights. It's a dictatorial regime. Of course it's more efficient. And I believe that this is sort of the cusp of their attraction to China and the reason that they are prepared to do the shilling for China. It's not about money. It's about their embrace of the efficiencies that a dictatorship provides. And that, in my mind, should be a frightening thought for all of us who are living in the midst of what a lot of these tech titans are doing. Now, before we go to Wall Street, let's stay in California and just talk a little bit about LeBron James. LeBron James, obviously a cultural icon. Amazing basketball player, but of course has a major cultural role and makes statements on cultural and social issues that are given import by some people. I'm not quite sure why, but he's a cultural force and one to be reckoned with. And it's well known, of course, that a couple of years ago, when the Houston Rockets general manager tweeted something about supporting the cause of freedom in Hong Kong, LeBron James went ballistic and called him ignorant and said that anybody who believes what is being said about China is operating out of ignorance. This was a revelation to me because I did not know that LeBron James knew geopolitics, but apparently he does. But it was a remarkable statement for LeBron James to make, and he was highly criticized for it. But the problem is he has a long history of doing this. And the reason is he has deep commercial ties to Beijing that go way back to the beginning of his career. He, of course, has the deal with Nike that's valued at least at $1 billion. He owns a media company that has exclusive arrangements with Chinese state media. He's over in China most off seasons, dedicating basketball courts, engaging all kinds of commercial activities. The bottom line is that LeBron James recognizes that really his financial fortunes are more tied to the Chinese market than they are to the American market. And he's been shilling for China for more than a decade. Back in 2007, 2008, some people in the room will remember, there was a great human rights tragedy that was unfolding in Africa, particularly southern Sudan, the Darfur region, where the government, the central government of Sudan, was killing hundreds of thousands of black Christians in the south part of that country. And that regime was backed by the Chinese government. Now, there was a petition that was circulated in the NBA, a movement that was put together because, of course, the Beijing Olympics were coming up. And that petition was put together, and NBA players were asked to sign it as a show of support for people that were being murdered in Sudan. LeBron James refused to sign the petition and refused to criticize the Chinese government for their support of this brutal killing of hundreds of thousands of black Christians in southern Sudan. And so it makes you wonder, and it reveals what LeBron James's priorities are. And it can only be asked of LeBron James, did those black lives not matter? Of course they did. But they didn't to him because his commercial interests were tied up with the entity that was backing the government that was doing the killing. Now let's go to Wall Street and talk about Wall Street. This is the beacon of American capitalism, the heartbeat, supposedly, of the free enterprise system that we have. The problem is that many of the largest firms, many of our largest firms, are doing major deals in Beijing, China, and their benefit by doing the bidding and the favor for the Chinese communist government. Their investments, of course, also raise lots of questions. Consider the fact that Blackstone, one of America's biggest investment firms, biggest private equity firms, is a major shareholder and anchor investor in something called JD Logistics. What does JD Logistics do? Well, they actually provide the infrastructure for the Chinese Air Force. Who is the Chinese Air Force going to be engaging their fighter planes against if war, God forbid, would come? That, of course, would be with the United States. Or if you look at the leader of Blackstone, Steven Schwarzman, he recently contributed $100 million to a program in China called the Schwarzman Scholars that brings Americans and individuals from the rest of the world to study for a year in China. And the goal, he says, is greater understanding between the United States, China, and the rest of the world. The problem is, of course, that the curriculum is all approved by the Chinese Communist Party. The applicants are screened in part by the Chinese Communist Party Youth League, and all students that go to China to study in this program are required to take classes in Marxism-Leninism with Chinese characteristics, which is the way that China describes Marxism-Leninism. So think about the irony of that. One of America's most successful financial titans, Steve Schwarzman, who formed and created this massive private equity firm called Blackstone, is literally financing a program to teach Marxism to American students going to visit in China. Finally, let me just say something in Wall Street about the largest hedge fund in the world, Bridgewater Associates. It's founded by a gentleman named Ray Dalio. Ray Dalio, very outspoken politically and elsewhere in the United States. Ray Dalio wrote a book a couple of years ago called Principles. Principles sounds like a very interesting and engaging book. I read it when I embarked on this project. And what was fascinating about it is that he has three or four pages in that book. This book came out, I believe, in 2017, about a Chinese official named Wang Qishan. And in this book, Ray Dalio describes how Wang Qishan has unlocked the keys to the universe to him. He describes Wang Qishan as a remarkable force for good over the decades of his public service in China. He describes him as a towering intellect. Well, I thought, this is remarkable. This guy is something else. I've got to figure out who Wang Qishan is. And what you find pretty quickly is that Wang Qishan is the second or third most powerful man in China, and he's President Xi's enforcer. In fact, The Economist magazine calls him the most feared man in China. When you hear these stories about Chinese businessmen or Chinese government officials or human rights activists disappearing, it's Wang Qishan that makes that happen. So what would prompt somebody like Ray Dalio, who's very bright, very smart, to say such ludicrous things about such an evil man? And all I could say is this, in my mind, demonstrates what selling your soul looks like. Because about a year and a half after that book was released with these wonderful words about Wang Qishan, and of course Ray Dalio said other nice things about China and the Chinese dictatorial regime as well, his firm, Bridgewater Associates, became the first hedge fund to be allowed to offer its products in mainland China to the average Chinese citizen. That's what selling your soul looks like. Now, some people may say, why should I care? How does that affect me? Should I really be concerned about this? I would say if you're concerned about the future of our country, if you're concerned about individual freedom, you should be terrified by what has been explained to you. Because here's why. The Chinese leadership, like the Soviet leadership in the Cold War, has laid out explicitly what their agenda is. Their agenda is to supplant the United States, to transform the international community, and change life here in the United States in ways that will no longer make it recognizable. And if you think that's an exaggerated statement, look at what is already happening. If you are in Hollywood and you produce a film, and you don't even intend to distribute that film in China, you just want to produce the film in the United States, the chances are you're not going to put anything critical about China in that film, because you know what? The next time you want to do a film and have it distributed in China, you're going to censor. And that's precisely what America's biggest movie studios are doing. If you look at the biggest news outlets that we have in the United States today, ABC News is owned by the Disney Corporation, or Bloomberg, or you know, the New York Times or other companies, they all have commercial ties and deals in China, which is influencing and directing the coverage that they are having in the United States. Change is happening in this country, and it's coming because of China's strategy that has been so successful. Now, if you go back in history and look at the question of why is it that we were supposed to have these commercial relationships with China, you go back 30 years, the idea was very, very simple, and I think very, very appealing. It was appealing to me initially as well. The idea was, if we engage with China, they start buying our blue jeans, they start listening to our music, they start selling products to us, they're going to become more like us. Here's the tragedy of where we are today. They have not become more like us. we have become more like them. And that's something that should concern everybody in this room. With that, I'll say thank you, and I'd be glad to take any questions you might have. Thank you. So any questions?
Yes, if you guys want to go ahead and raise your hand, Charlie and
yeah,
I.
Yeah, raise your hand. And Mike, so you guys go ahead and call him because I can't see with the lights.
Like we got a student right here.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hi.
My name is John Semple. I'm from Oceanside, California. And my question to you is this. You've been talking about kind of an economic takeover of China, maybe an idealistic takeover of China, even with some, you know, albeit with some words against China that are still in our culture. When do you think that would come to a culmination, and how do you think it would come to a culmination? Would the, for example, Taiwan-China war start it, or would that be farther down the future?
It's a great question. I mean, Taiwan comes up a lot, and there's no question that China wants to retake Taiwan, and they may do so militarily. But I think China's strategy is basically to win without actually having to fight a war. That's what elite capture is all about. They do it in Taiwan, they do it in Singapore, Australia, New Zealand, and the United States. They do it elsewhere. So I don't think their strategy is direct military intervention because they know that we have a more powerful military. Their strategy, I think, is far more sophisticated and subtle than that. And they're winning. They're winning the battle of the ideas because when you've got people like Bill Gates or Elon Musk or people like Joe Biden who are essentially saying the Chinese regime, you know, they're the good guys and they're like us and they're not all that different. What happens? The Chinese regime replays those interviews on Chinese state television. And they use it to legitimize them. And then they also use them in the developing world. You know, look, Elon Musk says we're good guys. Bill Gates says we're good guys. So in the battle of ideas, they are absolutely winning. And I think if you look back at Cold War history, what Ronald Reagan accomplished in winning the Cold War, I studied this, I've written a couple of books on this subject as well. What you find is it was really the battle of ideas. When he engaged in that, that's when the Soviet Union collapsed. And it's a powerful thing. The problem is, other than some statements during the Trump administration, we've had nobody in Washington, D.C. that is prepared to stand up and say, look, this is a evil, brutal, dictatorial regime that traffics in the body parts of their citizens, that has thrown a million of their citizens into concentration camps, that engages in brutal behavior. Nobody's prepared to say that. And until we are prepared to say that and engage in the battle of ideas, China will continue to win. So I think we need to focus on this issue because what Ronald Reagan understood is that the Soviet Union was, in terms of the appeal of its system, was a pygmy. People feared the regime, but they didn't embrace it. It's the same thing with China. There's a lot of people, if you came out strongly and said, this is an evil empire, this is a dictatorial regime, we reject it, we don't have a war with the Chinese people, we have a conflict with the Chinese Communist Party, that would go a long way, in my mind, in turning this battle around. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, who's ever next? I can't. Yes, over here.
Hi, Mr. Schweizer. My name is Joshua Fowler. I'm from Santa Clarita. My question is, on a military standpoint, it's well known that China's military, specifically nuclear forces, just as strong as ours, if not better. What would you say would be the best tactic to show our force without directly engaging in a war?
Well, I think you show strength, and that's the one thing I guess I would applaud the Biden administration on. There's not much because the Biden administration has caved in so many places. But you need to continue to show and demonstrate that even though China says the South China Sea is theirs, it's not. This is not, you know, preschool where you grab something and say it's mine and you get to keep it. So we have to do what the Biden administration has been doing, what the Trump administration did, and that is make sure that we send our Navy vessels into those waters to make clear that they're not Chinese territorial waters. But again, I think the focus that we have in our Western orientation in mind is to think of war as a kinetic war. People get killed, buildings get destroyed. That's not the way China focuses on these issues. There was a very influential book written in 1999 called Unrestricted Warfare by two colonels, Chinese colonels. The book was released publicly in China, and within 2 weeks, all the copies were confiscated. Now, fortunately, one was smuggled out, and it's been translated into English. You can find it online. Here's what's interesting. First of all, those two colonels, one of them just retired as a five-star general in the Chinese army. So his career actually did quite well having written this book. The second one is involved with a think tank in China that is very influential with President Xi. So what does unrestricted warfare say? It says, the United States is more advanced militarily than us. We will never be able to match them. So we've got to think of other ways to go at war with them. It talks about drug war. It literally talks about drug warfare, which is interesting in light of the problems we're having with fentanyl in this country today, right? It talks about trade warfare. It talks about warfare in a multitude of ways. And I think we need to start considering and realizing that's what the China threat is. And the battle of ideas is key in this. If you're not prepared to challenge the legitimacy of the Chinese dictatorial regime, they challenge our legitimacy all the time, but we never challenge theirs. You're ceding the battlefield to them and we're going to lose. So I would say we need to focus on those things more than the military hardware. I want a strong military. I want a big military, an effective military. But the threat we face from China, I think, is far more sophisticated and subtle than just that. So great question. Thank you.
Hi there.
Hi.
My name is Brian Murphy. I'm from Davenport, Iowa. And my question for you today is, you talk about how sophisticated China is. What can we do, I guess, to put an end to their regime?
Great question. So I would say a couple of things that we can all personally do, and I put myself in the same category. It is remarkable how many investment firms and funds in the United States are actually subsidizing and investing in the Chinese military. So I'll give you one small example. I don't have a large number of assets, but you know, I looked at my investment portfolio and I was in Fidelity as my firm, and I was invested in a worldwide fund. I had no idea. 30% of the holdings in this worldwide fund were Chinese firms, and more than half of them were directly tied to the Chinese military. So a lot of people in this room, if you have investments, if you're invested in developing world funds or international funds, chances are you are invested in Chinese military companies and intelligence companies that are specifically focused on overcoming the United States. So the first thing I say to everybody is make sure you aren't helping them, right? Before we think about how we can go out and defeat them, make sure you're not subsidizing and supporting them. And the second thing I would say is you need to engage and explain to people that the problem here is the Chinese Communist Party. It's a dictatorial regime. Of the 1.5 billion people in China, roughly 100 million of them are members of the Chinese Communist Party. Everybody else is part of the general populace and are oppressed. So let's focus on the true nature of the regime. And the reason I say that is that what the Chinese government has become very effective at doing is saying any criticism of China is anti-Chinese racism. No, it's not. It's not. I would argue the biggest victims of Chinese communism are the Chinese people themselves. Just like the biggest victims of the Soviet Union were the Russian people that weren't part of the apparatus that had to live in that kind of situation. So the second thing I would say, speak clearly about what we're dealing with and the nature of the threat that we're facing. And then the third thing I would say is let your elected officials know you care about this. Because a lot of members of Congress, I know some of them, they think the average American doesn't care all that much about foreign policy. This isn't foreign policy. This is the existential future of the United States and the nature of what kind of country we're going to have 20 years from now. There's already censorship taking place. Some of the censorship techniques that the big technology firms in the United States are using were actually learned from Chinese companies. Remember, we're becoming more like them. They're not becoming more like us. So America is changing in ways that are visible and in some ways still invisible, but they're changing. So you need to let your members of Congress know you are concerned about this threat and you're concerned about the challenges that it presents. And the fourth thing I would finally say is you need to call out people that are engaged in the sort of shameful behavior that I talked about here. There is no reason. I love a lot of the things that Elon Musk has done, but there's no reason that Elon Musk should not be called out for saying the wonderful rosy things he says about the Chinese government. So write these people, tweet at these people, communicate at these people, force them to be held into account for the things that they are saying and that they are doing. Because until they are shamed in that way, I don't think there's any chance that their behavior is going to change because they haven't paid any price for engaging in it. So, great question.
We have time for two more questions here.
Two more questions.
Peter, you mentioned, excuse me? Oh, okay. You mentioned the three areas of Chinese influence, government, Silicon Valley, and Wall Street. And for this particular audience here today, there's also been a lot of discussion and investigation into Chinese influence in education, higher education.
Absolutely.
I'm sure you've probably given a lot of thought to that. So maybe you could comment on that influence and what, you know, here we have all these probably several dozens of college students here. That what would you say to them about the influence of the Chinese government within education?
It's a great question. It's a great question, and it's a huge problem. I have a chapter on it in the book. It's an enormous problem. It's an enormous problem because universities have become so obsessed with raising capital for their endowments or for the operations of the universities that they have succumbed to that temptation by taking, in a lot of cases, money from overseas, particularly from China. And they mask it and they lie about it. So I talk in the book about Yale. You could say the same thing about Harvard, about a number of other universities that have taken in hundreds of millions of dollars from businessmen linked to the CCP and the Chinese government, and they've tried to cover it up. Now, according to a 1965 law, if Yale University takes money from a foreign national, they are required to disclose it to the Department of Education. They've received hundreds of millions of dollars from a Chinese businessman named Zhou Sai that they initially never disclosed, and now they are trying to cover it up. So, first of all, who is Zhou Sai? Zhou Sai is the founder of Alibaba, which is a massive, massive tech company in China. And Alibaba is enormously successful. Zhou Sai is one of the early businessmen. If you look at the history of Alibaba, it is joined at the hip with the Chinese government. The earliest investors were the so-called Red Princelings, who were the children and family members of China's political leadership. They do a lot of business with the Chinese government. The point is that Zhou Sai, as a Chinese businessman, has benefited enormously for his relationship with the Chinese government, and he's very pro-CCP. He goes on American college campuses and talks about how China's misunderstood. There's no human rights problem here. Ironically, at the same time, he's very involved with the Black Lives Matter movement in the United States, so figure that one out. But here's the thing that you need to know about what Yale is doing with Zhou Sai. They took in hundreds of millions of dollars. They set up the Sai Center at Yale's law school for the study of Chinese law. And as I recount in the book, it is an organization that takes a very pro-CCP look. They have glowing things to say about President Xi and about the Chinese leadership. So Yale was supposed to disclose publicly that they took this hundreds of millions of dollars, according to federal law. They failed to do it. They say, now we have disclosed it. Everybody can see it. When you go and look at the top donors to Yale University, the country outside of the United States that has donated more money than anyone else is, and we want to guess what they list it as? The island nation of Guernsey, all right? Now, I didn't even know where Guernsey was, okay? Guernsey is over in the Atlantic. It's near the UK. It's a tax shelter. So they will list as one of the largest origins of their foreign money is the island nation of Guernsey, which is, of course, where Zhou Sai keeps his offshore accounts. So they're being dishonest and they're lying about it because they know that alumni and some students at least would be very upset and concerned about this. And this is happening all across the United States. And if you criticize the Chinese regime on some college campuses, it's going to get you in major trouble with the president's office and others because they are so hungry for this Chinese money. which is ironic given that universities are teaching so many people that they are too obsessed with capitalism, free markets, and they're too money grubbing. And yet this is the way so many of these universities operate today. So I want to say you thank you very much. I appreciate you've been a wonderful audience. I'll be signing books in the back there, and I hope you have a great rest of the conference. Thank you for coming.